Radio frequency interferences, also known as QRM, have become a significant issue in modern times. Today, I will present a structured approach to tackle this problem and include interferences of power line communication devices and solar optimizers. This video will provide valuable insights and benefits for individuals residing in regions where modern technology is prevalent. It will also prove particularly useful for those considering the installation of a solar power plant or for individuals living close to such facilities. Hello, wireless enthusiasts. Here is the channel with a strange Swiss distortion in the signal, with a new video around wireless and other exciting stuff. Remember to subscribe if you do not want to miss the following emissions. While using solar power for electricity generation is a brilliant idea, it can have drawbacks for radio reception, primarily when optimizers or microinverters are employed. This issue has been known for some time, and I took a warning letter from our authorities as a chance to extend the topic to a general guide for hunting RF noise shown in this video. The same is true for PLCs or cheap power bricks. They solve a problem for the owner, but can drive others crazy. So in this video we will examine different sources of interference, explore devices and antennas for the interference hunt, learn a sequential approach to get and eliminate them. Finally, observe and listen to typical interference generators on their specific frequencies. But first, let's take a closer look at the problem. We live in a residential area surrounded by numerous homes, and I use an end-fed antenna for my shortwave radio hobby. I connected a Spectron V6 SDR receiver to this antenna to gauge the overall situation. It provides real-time information within a frequency range of 5 MHz to 6 GHz. Unlike an RDL SDR dongle bandwidth of 2 MHz, or the HAC RF with 6 MHz, this receiver's impressive 245 MHz bandwidth allows us to observe this broad spectrum. The display begins at 5 MHz, where we can observe the crowded HF bands up to about 60 MHz. Further, we encounter FM radio stations at 100 MHz, followed by pagers around 160 MHz. The most prominent services include various 4G and 5G signals, as well as 2.4 GHz Wi-Fi. Interestingly, we do not observe much activity at 5.8 GHz, possibly because my wire antenna is located outside the buildings and the 5 GHz signals do not easily go through walls. By transmitting on a simple Baofeng handheld, we can witness its emissions on 145.5 MHz, as well as unintended emissions on higher frequencies. The wide bandwidth of our receiver allows us to detect these emissions instantly. This is why these handhelds are illegal also for ham radio operators. The bands between the heavily utilized frequencies appear relatively quiet, posing no significant issues. A small remark to this Spectran receiver. During this year's ham radio exhibition at Friedrichshafen, Aronia unveiled the new Spectran V6 Echo, specifically designed for our beloved hobby. This impressive device not only delivers incredible performance, but also comes at a remarkably competitive price point. The new V6 Echo starts at 9 kHz, compared to mine, which starts at 5 MHz. Fortunately, we do not require such an advanced receiver for interference hunting. Later, you will see much simpler tools. To visualize the interferences, I will focus on frequencies ranging from 5 to 30 MHz because we saw that the higher frequencies were pretty clean. On 3.5 MHz, my end-fed antenna has a very narrow bandwidth and I rarely use it. Starting with a 40-meter band at 7 MHz, we encounter strong radio stations and broadband interference signals. For instance, this signal here exhibits an exceptionally wide bandwidth. We will later identify its source. Looking at the overall situation, we see a massive room for improvement. As promised, let's adopt a structured approach. First, we classify the sources based on their distance from our home, differentiating between three categories. First, far away, second, neighborhood, and third, inside our home. Why is this classification important? Well, while we have no control over stations located far away, we can influence installations within our homes. For neighbors, it becomes a matter of personal decision. The next question is, how can you detect these signals? While using a broadband SDR receiver is convenient, it is unnecessary. The simplest approach is to use one of those world receivers, or, if you are a ham radio enthusiast, a portable shortwave radio like the IC705. Simple SDR receivers such as an RTL SDR dongle or preferably an SDR play can also be utilized when connected to a laptop. Later, you will get a list of frequencies to watch with such receivers. Before we proceed, we must check our detection setup for any emissions. This laptop emits noise across several frequencies, which can be detected with an attached SDR receiver and would lead to wrong decisions. Therefore, testing our equipment away from urban areas is crucial to ensure it remains quiet or note frequencies where it generates interference. Now let's consider the choice of antennas. Because it is the primary antenna for my hobby, I used my EndFed antenna as a reference. Ensuring a clean signal from this antenna is essential, of course. It is also best to detect Category 1 signals. A telescopic or loop antenna is better suited for detecting Category 2 or 3 sources because they are mobile and less sensitive. Alternatively, you can employ such probes for precision localization in the near field. Next, how do we distinguish between signals from these three categories? Let's begin with Category 1. Signals originating from distant sources often exhibit varying signal strength, or are absent at different times of the day because of propagation. Radio stations can be identified using a simple receiver as they operate on specific frequencies and often can be demodulated. On the other hand, over-the-horizon radars disturb a wide range of frequencies and are best observed in a waterfall display. For now, we will skip Category 2 and jump to Category 3. Emissions produced within our homes because they are easily recognized. The easiest method to identify these sources is by using a battery-operated receiver and completely turning off the electricity in your home. Gradually power up the circuit breakers, one after the other, and you will immediately notice when interferences start. Before we proceed further, we must locate and eliminate these sources. This is where a portable device comes in handy. Select one of the frequencies you know originates from your home. You should know where to begin the search, because this interference started when you switched a particular breaker on, it must be in its influence area. You can utilize either a loop or telescopic antenna. The advantage of a loop antenna is its directional capabilities. This small probe is particularly helpful for very short ranges. They are often used to hunt signals on PCBs. In my shack, I discovered several power supplies emitting noise. This is an original Yealink, while this one is a cheap Chinese variant. Both cover a wide frequency range, so I disconnected them during our investigation. I probably will replace them later. Once we have silenced all internal noise sources, we can proceed by connecting the external antenna. At this point, we come across another peculiar wideband signal. Could it be another power supply? Luckily, that's not the case. How do I know? Look at the 20-meter, 70-meter and 15-meter bands. Here we observe significantly less noise. Quite intriguing. Fortunately, I have Celso here, who possesses extensive knowledge about interferences. He recognizes these signals as originating from a power line communication or PLC device. Suppliers were forced to notch out specific frequencies used by ham radio stations and other critical services. By the way, this illustrates the impact of our club memberships. Without the intervention of ham radio clubs and the International Amateur Radio Union, such measures would not have been implemented. You can listen to the typical noise emitted by these devices on the 19 and 26 MHz bands, as these frequencies are not notched. Additionally, you may hear it above 30 MHz. This is true for devices sold in Switzerland. Regulations may vary in other countries, and maybe also the frequencies. Therefore, we can guess that one of my neighbors is utilizing such a device to transmit internet signals between floors via power lines. Further investigation is required to identify the culprit. If we identify the responsible neighbor, we should discuss the possibility of switching off the PLC device for our investigation. If that is not feasible, we must subtract this noise from our future observations and preferably focus the search on the notched out bands. This allows us to progress to the next level, exploring solar panel optimizers and microinverters. We could test optimizers from Huawei and microinverters from Enphase because I use those in my setup. To evaluate them, we follow the same procedure as before. We turn off the solar power plant and check for any differences. Thankfully, the Huawei optimizer and the Enphase IQ7 Plus were RF quiet. However, some solar edge optimizers emit a distinct sound every 200 kHz or so. To ensure our observations are not influenced by a nearby PLC interference, we focus on the notched out areas at frequencies such as 14, 14.2, 14.4, 18, 18.2, and 21, 21.2 or 21.4 MHz. These can be listened to with a general purpose shortwave radio. During our investigations, we discovered a solar edge installation a few blocks from my home. Fortunately, the plant across the street remained silent. It uses newer optimizers because it was installed last year. Later in the day, we inspected my brother's installation in another village. He uses solar edge P404 optimizers and we did not hear the typical noise. However, nearby optimizers emitted substantial interference. This suggests that SolarEdge had learned from past mistakes, perhaps because their products were banned in certain countries. Currently, the legality of some microinverters is also being challenged in Germany. If you encounter optimizer issues, it is crucial to determine the noise source and discuss the matter with your neighbor. In Switzerland, SolarEdge was required to rectify several installations by incorporating numerous ferrite cores between the optimizers. Additionally, our authorities recommend adding a clause to contracts where optimizers are included, ensuring that they are removed if found to be non-compliant. Anecdotal evidence suggests that installers offered lower-priced alternatives without optimizers after requesting such a clause. If you are interested in how you can be cheated with optimizers, I have a video on my main channel discussing it in detail. Unfortunately, I am unfamiliar with the behavior of optimizers from other manufacturers, such as Tygo. If you have any information, please share them in the comment sections or send sound examples to me. Another source of noise to consider is XDSL telephone lines, which generate broadband noise up to 30 MHz. Suppliers can also notch out specific frequencies upon request. Fortunately, I do not have such devices near my home. To summarize, here is my proposal for a successful noise hunting expedition. Determine the gear you wish to use. For a comprehensive overview, an SDR receiver or a radio with a waterfall display is best. However, a simple shortwave radio is sufficient for targeting specific devices. Evaluate your receiving equipment for any noise emissions. Take it to a location away from urban settings to determine if, for example, your laptop generates interference. Monitor for remote signals and note their frequencies, as you cannot change them. Perform your further analysis on other frequencies. Fortunately, typical close-by noise generators emit signals across a wide range of frequencies, allowing detection on multiple bands. Identify and eliminate all noise sources within your home first. The best approach is to cut the power to your house and gradually power up the breakers individually. During further investigations, switch all internal noise sources off and deal with them later. If the noise does not originate from a faraway source and all internal noise has been eliminated, it is likely produced by a neighbor. In this case, we will likely discover power supplies or PLC devices that can be identified by listening inside the notched out handbands. Maybe your neighbor agrees to switch the suspected device off and on. Then it's easy to find the source. During this process, we also may encounter solar edge optimizers, which emit characteristic sound on frequencies such as 14.2 MHz. Why solar edge? Because they own a significant share of this business. Feel free to contribute your tips and frequencies to monitor particular sources. Together, we can compile a comprehensive collection. The chance for a noisy environment is much bigger in crowded areas and where people have enough money to buy technical stuff. That concludes today's video. As always, you can find the relevant links in the video description. Wishing everyone 73, and please consider supporting the channel using the links in the description. I'll see you in the next episode.